Minutes past nine. And we've got a special guest on the line.
Yes, Annette. We do, Mark. Today we have a very special interview with a man who is the highest paid and most popular successful Australian child star. Many accolades to his name, and he is one of Australia's finest entertainers. So I would like to say good morning and a big hello to Jamie Redfern. Good morning, Jim. How are you?
Hello, Annette. Hello, Mark. How are you? I'm good.
Very well, thank you.
Thank you so much for having a chat with us today.
It's okay. I was actually enjoying the chat you were having with the lady from Bunnings, Val. I was learning quite a bit there, guys. I was.
So do you think you'll attend a DIY gym?
Do you know, I'll tell you, Annette, my brother Derek is brilliant with that. He and my father, actually, my dad, before he passed away, they worked together with the local housing commission, and they were tradesmen. They were carpenters.
Oh, okay.
And so he's one of those guys. He could run something like that. But me, I'm supposed to have a reasonably high IQ, but I cannot lift my hands and nail in anything.
Oh.
I'm just joking.
You'll have to get some lessons off Derek.
Well, I don't know. I should go and meet Val and say, okay, love, now look, I need to put a window frame together.
Well, that'd be good. I'm sure she'd love to show you how.
Yeah.
Now, Jim, all of Australia would know you from the Young Talent team. So,
it's terrible to be infamous, isn't it?
Oh, it's nice. You did a wonderful job back then, because it was one of Australia's, the television history's most successful ever variety show, and you were one of the first founding members, and that was back in 1971. So how did that all come about?
I actually was. I was the founding member. It's something I've always been really proud of, because I was the only Young Talent Time team member that didn't have to audition. I never auditioned. I was actually... through Evie Hayes, you know, my dad took me to meet Evie Hayes, and Evie became my teacher of singing and performance, and then she also became my manager and introduced me to Kevin Lewis and Johnny Young, who were partners in Lewis Young Productions, of course.
Mm-hmm.
And I was working on Happening 70 and Happening 71, that fabulous, you know, iconic rock and roll show. And I was there with John Farnham and Axiom in those days, Glenn Shorrock when he was with Axiom, and all of those other fantastic bands and singers. And then from there, I did that for about 2 years, and also did John's television show. He had like a morning show, introducing cartoons and all of that sort of thing. And I did that quite a bit with him. And then I remember there was a conversation that he was having with Kevin Lewis, and my dad was there too. And of course, I was just a little fella sitting there listening to this conversation, and they were talking about what they do for the future. Well, what could we do to utilize John's talents and utilize Jamie's talents? What could we do? And my dad said they began talking about Brian and the Juniors, which was something I'd been on for 4 years prior to that. In fact, mm-hmm. every member of the original Young Talent team came from Brian and the Juniors. And my dad said, you know, there's probably a need for another show like that. It did incredibly well. And it only the demise of that show only happened because Mac Irvine had a car accident, who was the producer. And it was just going from strength to strength. And so we kind of just, you know, realized there was an opening for a variety-type show starring kids and somebody hosting. And of course, John could sing. Brian Naylor was fantastic, but Brian couldn't sing. And Young Talent Time was born. And my dad actually gave the phone numbers of the other kids so that they could audition.
Oh, that's
for the other team spots in the show.
Now, it ran till about 1988, was it?
We went from 71, I think it was, till about 88, yeah.
Oh,
so it was a long time.
Yeah, that was a wonderful show. I used to watch it and sing along.
Now, tell me, did you sing along with us at the end with the All My Loving song?
Oh, only a little bit.
Just a little bit. Okay, off you go, Del.
Oh, no, I'm not singing today, Jamie. Thank you, though.
Do you know, every time I hit somebody with that, they never fall for it.
If I was standing next to you, that's a different story.
Yeah, I bet.
Now, with Evie Hayes and Johnny Young, did they have a sort of an impact on you at all the time you spent around them? Were they mentoring? And?
Yeah, very much so. Very much so. They're probably two of the biggest mentors. I always say that my greatest mentor was my dad. And even though Dad wasn't a singer or performer, he was an incredibly good teacher. He kind of just instinctively knew what really worked. And as far as show business was concerned, it was a great love of his. And Dad trained both Derek and myself, my brother and myself, pretty full on. And he managed me, road managed me, and all the rest of it. And so my greatest mentor was my dad, but I had lots of others too. There was, of course, John Young, and, you know, learning so much from him. There was Evie Hayes, who was just amazing, who was more like an auntie to me in the end, and you know, just a lovely lady.
Yeah.
And then there was Liberace and so many other people that I met and befriended, Johnny Carson, Engelbert Humperdinck, learning from Engelbert how to sing on stage or perform on stage and get away with Blue Murder when you didn't have a voice, because he didn't have a voice in Las Vegas. He got something called Las Vegas throat, where he couldn't sing.
Yeah.
And he explained that to me. And in the dressing room, I said, how are you going to perform? He said, just watch me. And just learning things from those people was amazing.
Yeah. Everyone's always learning something every day, aren't they? Doesn't matter what it is.
Yeah.
Yeah. Now, at the age of 17, you represented Australia at the World Popular Song Contest in Tokyo.
Oh, I loved it.
How was that experience for you?
Oh, it was amazing. I remember I was only, because for a 17-year-old, you're probably too young to remember, really, but when I was 17, I looked more like 12. I looked so young. And so I was over there, and it was at the Budokan Center in Tokyo, a 15 to 20,000 seat center. And the Japanese kids just took to me. And when we all went out to the bus, there was about 20 or 30 of us that would all get on the coach from the hotel to the venue. Then after the gig, each day we'd go, because there were heats and all sorts of things, and then we'd go from the venue once again back to the hotel. But I remember that the kids would surround, there was like thousands of kids surrounding the bus and shaking the bus and wanting my picture and my autograph, and everybody's saying, oh, how cool is this? We don't get that kind of a reaction.
Was that scary, though?
It was a bit scary, but I did. The thing that made me feel good was the fact that the people were smiling.
That's
there's something different when they've got a grimace on their face and a hateful look. Oh, boy, you don't want that, do you?
No, but, you know, I have a lot of music tour concert DVDs at home that I watch, and a lot of them were like, for example, the Celine Dion one, where she toured the world, and it showed all the foreign people. And it's something about music that just brings everybody together.
Oh, it does. Well, they say it's the universal language.
Mm.
It's just the rhythm, the feel. And I think it's the heart. It's like the pulse. The beat is so much like the pulse, that we feel. It's very much an instinctive thing, and we sort of connect with it. But it also, it's such a happy medium that I think it promotes peace and love so much. It really does. I mean, you've got your darker side of the music industry too.
Yeah.
But for the most part, it promotes peace and love and unity, and it's great.
Yeah, no, that's good. Now, also, about 1972, I think it was, you were a front runner for the Australian of the Year, but you were picked at the post by Shane Gould.
Yes, I did.
So how did you feel about being nominated for that award?
Oh, look, it was amazing. And I remember I was doing a gig. It was actually the day that I met Shane. And it was at the pool, the swimming pool, and there was thousands of people at this venue. And I was on top of it. They pulled in a double-decker bus, and I was on the top of the double-decker bus because it didn't have a ceiling on the top of the bus. It was like a party type thing that they'd created on the top of this double decker bus.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm up there with my band, and I'm doing more rock songs than anything. I don't know why, when I was a middle of the road singer, at that point I'd started off doing rock and roll, probably decided just to go back to it to show off a bit, because Shane Gould was there and she was sitting right next to me, though the audience couldn't see her because she was just below the bus line.
Yeah.
And we got on great. We kind of liked one another. I think we admired one another a bit, as you know you do when you're young kids. And I was showing off a bit, I think, singing more rock than anything else.
Mm.
And somebody came up to me in the dressing room, one of the officials connected with the Australian of the Year, and told me that it looked like I'd won the award. They can't say officially, but it was pretty much all set and done. And then, of course, as it turns out, Shane went on to win those gold medals, and bang, that was it.
Yeah, oh, never mind. Just the fact that you were nominated would have been enough, wouldn't it?
Oh, look, it's amazing. Like, for me, I look back on that, and I know somebody said, not long ago, oh, isn't that a problem? A shame that in those days they didn't have the junior, because you were both, either one of you could have been Australian of the Year, then the other one Junior Australian of the Year or whatever. I said, they didn't have that concept back then.
Yeah,
but so I then ended up being runner-up, which was, but still an amazing thing. It's like, when I did that celebrity sale of the century and I was in front the whole way, all through the heats and in the final, and then got pipped at the post by Gary Sweet by 5 points.
Yeah.
And, just to be runner-up in that was wonderful. My dad and I loved all of that. that type of thing. We used to watch it religiously, that show.
Yeah, no, that's good. Now, Liberace came to Australia, and he discovered you and invited you to return with him to tour America.
He did.
Now, how long did you do that for?
Well, I was actually, most people don't realise I was there for two tours and invited back for a third. And we were there for like, I think it was just on 18 months altogether. We were set to go there for 3 months initially, but it was very successful. And so they kept asking me to, you know, stay on a little longer. And then we finished the tour. We Dad and I would come back to Australia and we'd only be here a week or two. And I did some major gigs when Festival Hall was the big gig in those days. It was the big venues, the only one we had pretty much. And, came back here and met Michael Jackson and did my own gig, did some television specials, flew back to America again for the second tour. Then we came to Australia, we toured Australia. And then I got asked back for a third tour, but we couldn't do that because I was missing home too much.
Yeah.
Plus we were looking at recording for MGM and doing all sorts of other things too.
Yeah.
So life was pretty full on in those days.
Do you have a favourite memory of that time, of the tour with Liberace?
Well, there's heaps of them, to be honest with you. One of the, you know, meeting so many wonderful people and Liberace telling me, you know, each night he'd say, have a look at the audience, especially in Las Vegas. He said, have a look at some of the faces in the audience. And in that time, there were some of the biggest entertainers in the world. And I said, oh, wow, so-and-so's here and so-and-so and, you know, Ginger Rogers and Dean Martin and so-and-so and Sammy Davis Jr. I'd say, yeah, let's see them sitting out there. Yeah, they're here to see you.
Yeah.
They've come to see you.
Yeah.
I said, why? Oh, and he'd laugh. What do you mean, why?
Mm.
You know, the little boy with the big voice and you know, we regard you as the best in the world. And so these people are coming to see you.
Yeah.
And it was just amazing. But I remember mucking around with and became one of my great friends, the amazing Mama Cass from the Mamas and the Papas.
Okay.
Yeah, and we played I Spy. We were doing a television show and the cameras broke down and they were apologising to us and said, could you just humour the kid, would you mind? She said, no, we get on great. And we sat in the green room, just the two of us alone, for 5 hours playing I Spy and all sorts of games. And she was like a big sister. We just got on so well.
Well, that was good. Because you also appeared on the Johnny Carson show, and that had a viewing audience of over 40 million.
Yep, sure.
Was that amazing to you?
I did that, I think, about six times. They said by public demand, I kept getting asked back to do it. And John... A little bit about John. John was an amazing person. He really was. Like he's known as the greatest Tonight Show host that ever lived. But he was also an amazing person. We would go and meet him outside of the television show and you know, have meetings and dinners and whatever. And we also met him one time at one of his cabaret shows, and he introduced me in the audience. He was just such a wonderful man. As was David Frost, was another one. Brilliant man, passed away not too long ago.
Yeah.
Absolutely fantastic man.
Yeah. You mentioned before Engelbert Humperdinck.
Yep.
My grandmother used to have his songs and we used to sing them and dance around the lounge room all the time. I actually love his music.
Oh, he's fantastic. In fact, Derek, my brother, sings a lot of his stuff. I do the occasional song, but Derek Moore sings his stuff and he's very, very good at it, so it really suits him.
Oh, that's good. Now, Michael Jackson had seen you on television when you were in America and asked to meet you when the Jackson 5 were in Australia.
Yep.
Molly Meldrum said he was a fan of yours.
He was.
How did you feel about that, and did you get to meet him?
I did. I got to meet him about three or four times, and I was the first person to ever hear the recording when I was in America. He took me in to hear the recording of... I used to think it was... there was a certain song for years. I'd wrongly remember it being another song. But the song that I heard that was the first time that he'd ever done it, and he said to me, what do you think of it, the production? And it was Ben, which, of course, was about the little rat.
Yeah.
Yeah, Willard.
Beautiful
in the movie. And so I was the first person to ever hear that song. I said, oh, mate, that's fantastic. But when I met him and his brothers, it was at the Southern Cross Bowl. And Michael and I had a picture taken, and we've got that. I think I've got that somewhere on my website. And we didn't know anybody was there, but somebody was there taking pictures. Maybe it was Molly or, you know, I know he was there, but I can't remember him taking images. But all of a sudden there was this shot of me teaching Michael the 10-pin bowl, and that was great fun. So because he said to me all the time, man, how do you sing like you do?
Yeah.
And I said to him, well, can I put it back at you? I said, how do you dance like you do?
Yeah.
And he just started laughing.
Same thing, isn't it?
It was great fun, yeah.
Now, you mentioned Ginger Rogers earlier.
Yep.
Now, I believe you sat on her knees and they were insured for $1 million.
They were. And I said to her, I said, which one am I? Because she said to me, the way it came up, she said to me, we're having a little cuddle when we're doing a television show. And she was talking to me about show business and, you know, what it is that you need to do and you need to know and you need to look after yourself. And then she said, you know, make sure that you insure your voice. Your voice is insured. It's the best voice in the world. And she said, it is insured for $1 million, isn't it? And I said, well, that was the going thing in those days.
Yeah.
And I said, no, I don't think so. Oh, look, sweetheart, please look into that. She said, my legs, I'm a dancer, known as one of the best dancers who ever lived. And she said, and which is lovely for me to have that title. She said, but, you know, my legs are good legs too. They're good pins, she called them. They're good-looking mm-hmm. pins. And she said, and I've had them insured for years. And I said, really? She goes, yep, $1 million. And I said, okay, so each one 500,000. No, one 600,000, the other one's 400. I said, why is that? She goes, oh, too long a story, that's what it is. And I said, okay, which one am I sitting on? She said, the $400,000 one. And I changed legs. I said, I don't like cheap seats. And she just started laughing.
I read that, actually.
Yeah, it was so funny.
So that was good. Now, tell us how you came to meet your lovely wife, Judy.
I met Jude at a nightclub, actually, the Sheik's nightclub, which was in Bourke Street many years ago. And what was it, Collins Street? No, I think it was Bourke Street. Yep, pretty much Bourke Street. Anyway, my memory's getting a bit vague now on the streets. But I know it was Sheik's nightclub, which was somewhere I used to go. I used to feel quite comfortable. I knew the management got on well with them. And all of a sudden, there was this pretty young girl. She was sitting there. My friend said to me, go and meet her. She can tell she wants to meet you. I said, oh, she wouldn't want to meet me. And he had a bet with me. He said, go on $20 that she'll say yes to a dance. And he egged me on about it so much that I said, okay. And I ran over and I said, hello, love. Would you like to dance? She said, no, thank you. I don't like the song. And I kind of sat there and went, oh, okay. So I looked across at him and I sat next to her and I said, no, no worries. Looked back at him and said, there you go, mate. You owe me $20. And then she bumped me and said, I really like this next song. Let's dance to that one. And then from there, we just kind of got on really well. We just clicked.
That was good. So how did she cope with your popularity, especially with the female fans?
Well, she seems to understand that. I have had girlfriends throughout the years who didn't really take to that too well. They couldn't sort of understand it. But she seemed to just get it. She seemed to really understand it. Yeah. And she's a dancer too. The ironic thing was I told her, of course, I'm in performing arts. She said, well, so am I. I'm a dancer. And she was one of Australia's best young ballet dancers when she was only 10 years of age.
Amazing.
And so, of course, it was inevitable that we opened schools together later on.
Yeah. So how long have you been married for now?
We've been married now for about 25, 26 years.
Oh, that's wonderful.
Yeah.
So being in the show business industry, what do you think the secret is to keeping a successful marriage?
I don't think there's anything different, with show business than anything else. And I think about this all the time, and I've always, got the same response. In fact, I tell my girls, I teach my girls about it. I often say to them that, if you're not best friends with your partner, then that's when you have trouble. You've got to be best mates. You've got to be best friends.
Yeah.
But the romantic side and all the rest of it, the other side, is terrific. It's just great. But the essential thing, the thing that really bonds you together is that friendship. And the friendship is born of trust, and that's why trust is so important in a relationship. But if the trust is broken for any reason, you might want to go back into the relationship and try to, remedy things and fix it up. But it can quite often never quite be the same.
Yeah, I understand that. Now, you've written some songs for The Wiggles. How did you feel about writing children's songs?
Yeah, I actually started writing them in it for myself because I thought to myself, a friend of mine said, you'd be good as a songwriter. I said, why? He said, well, your musicality. I said, well, I used to write a little as a kid, but I didn't think they were any good. Other people did, but I really didn't. And so he said, look, I've got, some software that I know of that I can put you onto. I said, no worries. I said, I'm not really computer literate, which I wasn't at that point. I can practically break a computer down nowadays and build it back up again.
Mm-hmm.
But at that point, I wasn't. This was a few years back. And so I got the software, and before I came, brought it home, and before you know it, I'd written a really nice song. And I said to Judy, oh, okay, well, this doesn't seem too tough. And then I thought, now, how can I use this? But, well, rather than the talent school kids going out to do exhibitions at shopping centres or festivals and just doing your everyday songs, wouldn't it be lovely to create characters? And because I write children's stories too. That's something I'm looking to do in the future. In fact, I'm working on it as we speak. And so I sort of said, you know, it'd be nice to have character shows and original songs so that it really is like a show that people can bring their kids to. We can do DVDs, whatever. And so I started doing that. Now, I ran it by, at one point, Anthony from the Wiggles, because we're good friends. He said, oh, Jim, they're great songs, but don't let me hear them anymore because they can inadvertently be in my mind and I write a song and I kind of, you know, do one of your lines or melody by accident, so it's best not to let me know. And then, as it turns out, I ended up doing a DVD with the Wiggles, their Hot Pop and Popcorn, one of the major songs, the major track on one of their DVDs, Hot Pop and Popcorn, which was really successful. They asked me to do that, so I said yes. And eventually it led to me submitting some songs to them, and there are a couple of songs they're very interested in recording now.
Well, that's wonderful, because at the moment you actually are working with Derek, like in the Redfern Brothers duo, doing some shows around Australia.
I am, which is really good fun. And we rehearse once a week, which is a bit difficult. We're so committed to so many other things. So to get together even for the once a week is a bit difficult. But at the same time, we just love to do it. And when we're on stage, we just get one another. We used to work together. Dad trained us when we were kids to listen and think the same. And, you know, and it's funny how you go onto a stage and all of a sudden it just becomes kind of natural and you fit right back into it again. But nowadays we're heading towards a little more pop rock stuff than we did before. We were very, very much cabaret. And there's still quite a bit of that in the show. We're kind of weaning that out to a degree. I'm not getting too severe on that because some of it is very, very good material. But, yeah, we're enjoying that, developing the show. And plus, I'll be doing some shows on my own. Derek does some on his own still, and I'll be doing some stuff on my own as well in the future.
Well, hopefully you'll both be heading to the Bacchus Marshway and we can all come along and see you.
Yeah, that'd be lovely.
Yeah, we'd really enjoy that. Now, you and Judy run a business.
Yep.
To do with talent, and I believe you have a similar show to the Young Talent Time called Jamie Redfern's Rascals.
Yeah, well, it's gone through a name change 3 or 4 times. It started off as Jamie Redfern's Super Kids, then it became Jamie Redfern's Rascals, and the Rascals are kind of still involved in the concept anyway. And then it came to its final name change, which is Jamie Redfern Presents, which means I can kind of do anything. It doesn't matter what I'm presenting. I thought, look, I'll settle on that name. But, of course, when we start doing some shows, hopefully in 2014, we go back to doing that because they've been showing some old shows and stuff. And they've been rating really well. I remember even on Channel 31 in Melbourne, we were getting 80,000 viewers sometimes, which is amazing for community television.
So what channel are they on now?
It's not on now. They still show it apparently on Foxtel because it rates so well.
Okay.
So on Foxtel, the Aurora channel, they will still show it on odd occasions. But they showed it so full on for so many years. I just kept asking me, could we keep playing it? I said, well, as long as it rates well, it's up to you. You know, feel free to do that. So they did that. But they're longing for us to come up with some more productions, which we're longing to do now. The global financial crisis hits every business, and of course it's hit ours too.
Yeah.
So we haven't really been able to do what we wanted to do. But things are picking up quite a lot now, so it'd be lovely to get some kids out there again, Annette. And, because it's a nice vehicle. I mean, I love doing it. I love producing it. It's all creative. I love hosting it. And introducing great kids to the masses is a wonderful thing.
Yeah. Now, if anyone is interested in finding out about your talents, business and singing lessons and acting and all that sort of stuff, where do they go to actually find you?
Well, the best thing is the website, which is showbusiness.net.au.
Okay. Yeah. It's actually a great site. I got on there the other day and had a bit of a look around and found all different avenues that you're getting into.
I haven't had I normally fix it up every week. I do lots of little gizmos. I'm quite good with that. I kind of study up on how to fix up websites, and I sort of took to it. And so I've been getting back into that a little bit. I must admit, I've been so busy doing so many things, even working for Gray's Fitness.
John
Gray, who was an ex-wrestler.
I saw that you've got a link coming soon on your website about health and fitness.
Yes, exactly.
So
and that's something I do, marketing, online marketing and promotion and online sales and help them with marketing and that sort of thing.
Yeah, that's now I'm going to read out some of your many accolades, Jim.
There we go.
Okay, so just give me a minute for this.
Yeah.
We have 22 silver record awards, 22 gold awards, which is the equivalent of numerous platinum awards by today's standards.
Yep.
Logie Awards.
Yep.
The King of Pop Awards, which was Australia's Best Male Vocalist.
Yep.
Winner of Australia's Most Popular Record of the Year Award 3 times.
Yeah.
Record-breaking return appearances by public demand on 6 major USA television shows, including Johnny Carson and The Mike Douglas Show.
Yeah.
The amazing title of Australia's Mr. Show Business.
Yeah, that was lovely. I got called that again not too long ago.
That's wonderful. 2 Royal Command performance invitations.
Yep.
And named by Elvis Presley and Sammy Davis Jr. as the best child singer and performer in the world. That is an amazing career.
Yeah, but don't forget runner-up to Australian of the Year.
Oh, yes. I left that one out because we talked about it. So that was good. Look, you've had a really amazing career, Jim, and I congratulate you, and especially on everything that you and Judy are doing for children and acting and singing. And I know that you're a busy man, so we're really glad that you took the time to have a talk to us.
Oh, it's terrific to talk to you too.
And we hope that you'll come back and have a chat another time.
We certainly will. Be lovely. Be nice to do that, actually. And maybe present some wonderful kids or something and let them sing a song or two. We can pre-record some stuff.
We'll work something out. That'd be wonderful. Thank you so much. We've been listening with Jamie Redfern this morning. So thank you, Jamie.
Thanks, Annette.
Thank you, Jamie.
Thanks, Mark. Bye, mate.
Bye.